स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतारवरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः। असतो मा सद्गमय तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय असतो मा सद्गमय तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्योर्मामृतंगमय। ओम शांति शांति शांति। लेट अस ऑफर अवर सैल्यूटेशंस टू श्री रामकृष्ण द एम्बॉडीमेंट ऑफ ऑल रिलीजन्स द एस्टैब्लिशर ऑफ यूनिवर्सल रिलीजन। लेट अस pray to the Divine Spirit to lead us from unreal to the real, to lead us from darkness of ignorance to the light of knowledge, to lead us from death to immortality. Peace, peace, peace be unto all. Today's topic is discovering freedom. So we are all aspiring to have that wonderful freedom, which means we'll be free from all types of bondage. We will be well established in perpetual peace and bliss. But our life depends upon what we are aspiring for. If you want to discover freedom, you have to have one approach. We should earnestly desire to have that experience of absolute reality, which only gives us real peace. What we see in the world, people every day, new sets of people are coming, every day people are dying. The whole process of creation is going on continuously from the time immemorial. Nobody knows when this originally started. People keep on coming, people keep on dying. It's going on. No beginning, no end. Anadi, Ananta. These are some of the basic factors which we should remember that will help us to analyze our life. The transmigration results from ignorance, and its cessation by the advent of right knowledge is liberation. These two, therefore, stand for the state of ignorance and enlightenment. In one state, we are conditioned by desires and actions. We are bound by our own desires. We are bound by our own actions. Asha paasha shatair baddhaha kamakrodha parayanaha. The embodied beings are tied by the ropes of innumerable desires. In the state of ignorance, we see the world outside of us as distinct from ourselves. The world consists of many things, many objects, which appeal to our senses. Immediately we are attracted by them, thinking that they are other than ourselves and therefore do not belong to us. We instinctively entertain a desire to come by them and then make frantic efforts to get at them, make them our own and enjoy them. All this proceeds from the false belief that the source of joy lies in these objects and not in ourselves. This false belief is the root of all our suffering and restlessness in the life. Suppose you take an example of a vendor. He walks along the street shouting, "Here we have got plenty of mango fruit. Please come and buy them. Fresh from garden has come." He keeps on shouting to attract the people towards him. We hear them. We come out to purchase some of the fruits. We feel satisfied when we have cut the fruit into slices and eaten them. This instance is typical of all the other things for which we conceive a desire. The natural equipoise of the mind is disturbed when desire enters it and is again restored with the gratification of the latter. But there is no guarantee that it will not be disturbed again, for our desires are multitude. It is not that one desire is over, finished, I am quite safe. No. Even before the completion of or satisfaction of one desire, already 10 more desires have come in the place. As a result, we are always busily engaged in tackling our desires, rubbing our mind, using all our resources to get into them. Not only that, things when we desire, we don't desire for our own selves, but we also desire them for our nearest and dearest friends, relations, children, etc. In the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, there is a famous saying which says, Mamedam Syat Putrasya Idam Bharyaya Idam. These things I have got, this is for my children, this is for my wife, this is for my friend, this is for my relations. So like that, we keep on thinking in the mind about the desires all the time. As soon as some desires are fulfilled, 10 more crop up in their place. The more we try to gratify them, the more they multiply. The attempt to come to the end of them by this method is bound to prove futile. So Manu says, a great lawgiver, Najatu kamaha kamanam upabhogena shamyati havisha krishna vartmeva bhuya eva abhi vardate. It's a famous saying. You can as well hope to quench a blazing fire by pouring a quantity of ghee on it as to put an end to desires by satisfying them. Tatakim. What then is to be done? How can we root out desires and experience undisturbed peace of the mind? As long as mind is filled with desires, peace is far, far, far away. So we have to put a stop for the desires at some point of time. Thus far, no further. That stand we will have to take, it must be taken, then only we can have the joy of perpetual peace. That is to say, the extermination must be complete, for if any trace of it is left behind, it will gather momentum and raise up its ugly head again. These desires, they are so terrible. They have also a knack of going underground and laying in wait to reassert themselves when we are a little off our guard. That's why we always give primary importance for our spiritual austerities. If you slacken a little, immediately you don't know what is waiting for you. There's every chance of falling down from the heights of spiritual ideal. Or sometimes these desires may appear to disappear in one form only to reappear in another way, more subtle and therefore more difficult to detect and subdue. In view of these difficulties, we can never be too sure that we have completely conquered our desires. We can never say that, nobody can say that he has conquered everything. No, he can't say that. Any moment, man's composure may fly to the winds, leaving him entirely at the mercy of an overmastering desires. There are many instances to prove this. There was a great saint, a very well-known saint, who was very simple, like a child, with unsophisticated manners, All the time he was in a wonderful spiritual atmosphere in the forest under the guidance of his spiritual master, his own father. So there was no diversion to the mind. Mind was clean, spotless. So naturally it was very easy for him to concentrate upon the object of meditation. And he did so, and he did make some progress in spiritual undertakings. In that process he acquired some mysterious powers. In the kingdom where this particular hermitage was there came a famine. No rains, no food, no crop. People are dying, cattle are dying, animals are dying, everywhere destruction everywhere, playing of death. No one can see devastating effect of the famine. Somebody suggested to the king, "O king, there is only one way to get over this famine. Nobody else can do anything for this. The only way is to tackle it in this way. That is, there is a particular saint in a forest, in that particular hermitage. If you try to bring him somehow to this place, to this kingdom, on the very first day of his stepping into this kingdom, you will get plenty of rains because of his spiritual powers. He is a holy man. But to get him to this place is not easy." So immediately the king got the idea, and he sent some of the beautiful ladies of the place to go and make him come to the kingdom. So they all went there. And the sage, up to that time he had not seen women at all. So for the first time he is seeing them, he was so much charmed by them. And finally, they appealed to him to come to the kingdom. So they were succeeded. So they took him to the kingdom. Immediately a lot of rains came, lot of crops came up, there was prosperity everywhere. So, but the point is how, though he was well disciplined and his mind was in a very high level, unawares he was caught. He was taken down, taken by those women coming from the kingdom, and he was attracted by them and he went along with them to the place. Like that, there are many, many instances where we do not know when the desires in the subtle form would come up and cause disturbance to us before we reach the goal. So what is to be done now? All these things are only to show it is rather very difficult to eliminate all the desires from the mind. As long as we exist in this body and mind, desires do exist. Without desires, man will not survive. He cannot survive. He must have something to hold on. something to hold on. That's very important. So when we are placed in that predicament, what is the way out? We know desires bring misery. We know that. It is not that we don't know. But we can't help it. We want to come out of them, but we can't come out. Again and again we are pulled down by desires. So we have no alternative but to try a more positive method. Positive method. What is that? This method consists in replacing our gross material desires by slightly more spiritual ones. Replace those desires with spiritual desires. Such as harmless pleasures and joy arising from the appreciation of works of art. By gradual stages we must learn to find joy in things of the spirit and in selfless service. Long and steady effort in this direction will bring us to a stage when we can substitute one all-absorbing and comprehensive desire in the place of our diverse, distracting and multifarious desires. So we should adopt such a desire. We should overcome all other desires. This single desire which can effectively replace the motley crowd of unblessed cravings must be both satisfactory and satisfying. Unless it is spiritual through and through, it cannot serve the purpose. It must be the embodiment of the highest truth and the highest value. It must be the finest and ultimate essence of all our ordinary desires. It must arise out of their sublimation. A little reflection will show that our common desires, shorn of their material associations, simplify themselves surprisingly to a mere vague and inarticulate longing. It requires the eye of a mystic to discover in this longing the passionate desire of the finite self to rejoin the infinite self. So desires, when directed towards spiritual objects, undergo a sea change and get completely transformed in the process. Let us take the example of the famous Gopika episode in Srimad Bhagavatam. The gopis, they began to love Lord Krishna. Though their love began in the ordinary way, like between the human beings, but then soon under the imperceptible influence of Lord Krishna, it was divested of all dross and became pure, passionless, and they become so devoted and dedicated. It then symbolized the eager desire on the part of the jivatmas, the embodied beings, to become one with the Paramatma. So desires in the final analysis signify the finite beings longing to regain the paradise which they appear to have lost by sheer ignorance and folly. So, the point which I am trying to tell you is that we should find out such desire which would replace all the other desires which are disturbing us. So that desire, which can overcome all other things, which can swallow up all other things, like a big fish swallowing the small fish, is the Atma Kama. If at all you have to have a desire, you desire to have the realization of your true nature. Who am I? What is this? I want to know. So you concentrate on that desire. The more you concentrate on that particular desire, the more you are away from the other desires. So this is a sovereign remedy recommended by the great Maharshi Yajnavalkya. He says that a man becomes desireless when desires leave him. This happens when he has attained all the objects of his desire. This in turn becomes possible when the Atman takes their place. Yo akamo nishkamo atmakama atmakamo bhavati, Brihadaranyakopanishad says. The Atman, being the highest truth and the highest value, must be the sole object of a man's desire. Again the Upanishad says, the wife, husband, children, possessions, they are all dear to us. They are dear not for their own sake, but for the Atman that they embody. See? Sahova chanava are patyuk kamaya patif priyo bhavati. Atmanastu kamaya patif priyo bhavati, nava are jayaye kamaya jaya priya bhavati, atmanastu kamaya jaya priya bhavati. Famous Upanishadic statement. Again, the Maharshi says that the Atman is dearer than one's own son, wealth and everything else that one may hold dear. Husband loves wife, wife loves husband. It is because of the Atman in them. So that is the object of attraction. That is the object of love. If the spirit is not there, you don't love the simply body. If the spirit leaves the body, you are afraid to go even near the body. You will be thinking of cremating the body. The body is no more alive. So all your love terminated there. So your love existed because of the Atman. So all our love towards the things of the thing, objects, things in this world, is because of the existence of the Atman, the Spirit. Lord Krishna reinforces this truth in the Gita, that one gaining which one thinks there is no greater gain, and wherein established one is not moved even by the heaviest of sorrows. Yallabdhva chaparam labham manyate nadikantataha yasmin stito na dukkena gurunapi vichalyate. From the context it is clear that the Lord is here referring to the realization of the Atman. The Atman, the Spirit, which is in everyone's heart, irrespective of caste, color, creed, race, religion, country, nation. It has nothing to do with all these, all external factors. Atman in everyone. We have to get into that. We have to desire to get into that. That desire must be intense. You must find to probe, to find out that. You must find to discover that. The freedom is there in discovering your own true nature. Then only you can enjoy true freedom. Against this background, we can understand The Maharshi's occasional references to the nature of the Absolute in the course of his talk on liberation. He speaks of Brahman, what I am referring to as spirit, the consciousness, as being supra-relational because it is beyond time, space and causal relation. Secondly, it is supra-rational because it arises above mind and speech and remains unknown and unknowable except by Shruti. Thirdly, it is yet the substance and sustainer of the universe because it is the vital force of the vital forces, the eye of the eye, the ear of the ear, the mind of the mind, the light of all lights. That means to say, it is the source of everything. It remains transcendent and untouched by the evils of the world, though in it the five groups of five rest. It is strictly one without a second, as it is devoid of difference of every kind, external, internal, or organic. It is pure and intelligence, being sentience, all compact. When the sage's main theme is to show how man can make the transition from the state of desires to the state of desirelessness. The transit is very important. How we are making the transition from the state of desire to the state of desirelessness. The sage refers often on to the nature of the Absolute. The reason is clear. He means to point out that it is only by hitching one's wagon to this bright particular star that one can destroy completely all the sundry desires that arise in the human mind. Now all this is very easily said but not so easily achieved. Strenuous, constant and unremitting effort is necessary to take even one forward step in the direction of the spiritual progress. So what is needed is first of all is that the mind must be cleansed of its age-long impurities in the shape of egoism, selfishness, arrogance, etc. It is no easy matter to rid the mind of these thick incrustations. The root cause of these undesirable qualities is the notion of I and mine. This is the root of ignorance. This is the root of all misery. Anything and everything happens, I identify myself with that and I say, I am doing it. I have not done it. This is mine. It is mine. So this feeling of I and mine is the greatest obstruction in our way to discover freedom. To overcome this false identification of the self with the non-self, the Maharshi recommends sacrifice, yajna, gifts, dhana, and penance, tapas. So, whatever we give to God, it's called yajna. Whatever we give to our fellow beings is called as dana. The act of giving, cleanses the mind. Simply giving the thing will not cleanse the mind. With what attitude you give, that's very, very important. So whenever you offer the thing to God or to a fellow being, you must always do it with this idea that not mine. In Sanskrit, there's a particular phrase. Whenever you offer anything to a person, you must always use this phrase and then offer it. When you give it, immediately you say, Na mama. Na mama. You don't desire anything in return. We are just given the thing out of love. If we expect anything in return, then the spiritual benefit is lost. You are blocking your own path. So Namama is a very important phase. Whenever you are giving anything to anybody, always think Namama, Namama, not mine, not mine. So when we make offering to the fire, when we do yajna, you know, sacrifice, agnaye swaha, agnaye idan namama, I offer it to God Agni, and again immediately he says, idan namama, not mine. When we give something to other human beings, the formula is, I give this to you, it is no longer mine. Tubhyamaham sampradade namama namama. So that's a very important idea. We should practice it in our activities. We do so many things. Simply doing is not a service. But if you do it with this idea, then it becomes service. So you must spiritualize everything. The aim in performing penance, the tapas, yajna dana tapas, these are the three ways, you know, to cleanse the mind that paves the way towards freedom. So what is the purpose of performing tapas or austerity? It is not to mortify the flesh, but to cultivate the feeling that the body is not an end in itself, to be pampered and well looked after, but just an instrument at our disposal, like any other, to be employed in promoting great causes. So these ideas we should always keep on thinking about. And we must think this constantly, because it is difficult at one bound to disown the body and declare I am pure spirit. It is not so easy. But as I said earlier, the transition must be done. It will be rendered easier if we provide for a halfway house between the two. Halfway house. Once we learn to look upon the body as a possession, like the house, the further stage of disowning it will not be very difficult. Ordinarily, a man may not like to walk barefooted in the hot sun, but he may bring himself to do it when he is on a pilgrimage to a holy place. Clearly, he then holds his body as an instrument to serve a higher purpose. When it comes to that, he cheerfully sacrifices his body in the interests of truth and righteousness. It then becomes very clear that he is prepared to throw away the body as if it were not his. To men filled with a high spiritual purpose, discarding the body is as easy as throwing away their tattered clothes, because he knows he is not the body. So yajna, dana, tapas, they are therefore indispensable helps in promoting the transition to desirelessness. They help man to get over the feeling of I and mine. With the disappearance of the false identification of the real self with the body, the other undesirable qualities like self-love, self-esteem, self-assertion, self-righteousness and self-centeredness, all these things will automatically make their exit. The formal study of the Vedas, especially the Upanishads, is also included in the discipline. It will help in speeding up the process by providing right notions regarding the nature of the self. This will fill up the vacuum created by the disappearance of the wrong notions. Once the mind is cleansed of its impurities, it will now be free to enter on the path of jnana, knowledge, which is a high road leading to liberation. Knowledge is very important. True knowledge regarding the nature of the self will dawn on the mind, thus purified as a state of consciousness. A further course of specialized discipline is, however, necessary before this can happen. The saving knowledge has to be acquired by sitting at the feet of the teacher, doing service to him, waiting on him, and listening to his words of instruction emanating from his authentic experience. So, service of the guru is very important and very helpful in our way to discover freedom. The words of the teacher have the effect of a mantra. They serve to rouse the aspirant from his age-long slumber, the slumber of ignorance, and tell him that he is not to identify himself with his body, senses and so forth, but that he is the same as the Supreme Spirit, which is one without a second. So this is the first step in the further discipline, and it is called Shravan, hearing this truth, contemplating it deeply. The next step consists in bringing thought to bear upon the teaching imparted by the teacher. This is the stage of reflection, and its aim is to secure intellectual conviction. It's called Manan. The last step is called Nididhyasan, and its object is to transform the teaching, which is indirect and mediate, into an immediate and direct experience. Thus the operation of the intellect mediates between what is learnt on authority and what finally emerges as a direct experience. Yajnavalkya Maharshi refers to this point and says, the intelligent aspirant after Brahman, knowing about this alone, should attain intuitive knowledge. Unless it is thus transformed, it will not be strong enough to prevail against sense perception, which presents a world of endless variety. No amount of intellectual conviction can stand against the testimony of the senses. Only an equally strong and felt experience, reinforced by deep thinking, can give the quietus to the verdict of sense perception. Then it will become a way of life, influencing every thought, word and deed. The outward life of such a man will reflect his deep Advaitic convictions, even as a clear mirror images the objects that are in front of it. It must be remembered that this specially Advaitic discipline, like the previous one, intended to purify the mind, has for its aim only the removal of hindrances. Once you remove the hindrances, the path is clear and you are on the way to discover the freedom. So liberation is not like any other ordinary end to be gained by employing appropriate means. It is, on the other hand, an ever-present reality and consequently ever attained, to be ever pure, ever enlightened and ever free. Nitya Shuddha Buddha Mukta Swabhava. That is the essence of the spirit that is residing in everyone's heart, even as heat and light are natural to fire. Just as heat and light are hidden in firewood and therefore concealed from our view, Even so, the real nature of the spirit is unmanifest owing to the false identifications bred by primeval ignorance. Just as combustion helps to bring out the latent heat and light of the wood, even so are the disciplines mentioned above are necessary to remove the erroneous notions regarding the nature of the self. When the obstacles are got out of the way, the Atman shines in its pristine glory, even as the sun or the moon shine in the heavens when the concealing cloud lifts. So, there is therefore no question of achieving liberation in the manner in which we achieve other ends. It is above the realm of means and ends, and consequently above. Therefore, no change comes upon the self. It is not like a prisoner breaking his fetters and becoming free. It is not like that. In truth, the self is never bound, and hence there is no question of its attaining freedom. Here the self means Atman, not the mind. Bondage and freedom have meaning in the empirical sphere, but not in the transcendental. Gaudapada, a great Vedantic scholar, a Maharshi, an enlightened saint, makes it quite clear. The supreme truth is that there is neither destruction nor creation, neither bondage nor striving, neither aspiration nor release. Na nirodho na chotpattihi na baddho na cha sadhakah na mumukshuhu naiva mukta ityesha paramarthata. So all our activities, whatever it is, belong to the realm of ignorance. Another important point we should try to understand, that it is wrong to think that in liberation the finite self loses itself in the infinite. As people many times they talk, the individual self gets merged into the universal self. The individuality is lost. People don't want to be lost that way. Rather, they prefer to suffer, but they want to retain their individuality. As long as you maintain that separateness, you are bound to have suffering, restlessness, all sorts of things. The very idea of separateness is because of the ignorance. So, the point here is that it is not the question of finite self losing itself in the infinite self. It is not that. There is no merger, but only an emergence. Emergence. To give an example, just as air, cloud and lightning rising out of that akasha space and reaching the highest light appear in their own form, so does the serene being rising out of the body and having reached the highest light appears in its own form. So, liberation, while still in this body, if only man makes full use of the opportunities that are open to him in this lifetime, and puts in the right kind of effort under proper guidances, there is no reason why he shouldn't become free here and now. Death is not a necessary precondition for release. After physical death, no positive qualification is going to accrue. Nor can it be contended that the presence of the physical body is a hindrance. Even the sense of ownership disappears at this stage, and the body is likened by Yajnavalkya to the cast-off slough of the snake. Just as the useless slough, S-L-O-U-G-H, slough of the snake is cast off and lies on the ant hill, so does this body lie. Tadyathahi nirvayani valmike mrita tatyastashayita eva mevedam shariram shete. From Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. What counts is the heartfelt experience of the liberated soul. This is the eternal glory of the knowledge of Brahman, that it gives one complete satisfaction. It gives the conviction that one is completely blessed. It requires no other witness than the testimony of one's own experience. Once he comes to know who he is, then he comes to know everything. Then he has discovered the freedom. So, we have got the life of great Mahatmas, where they had this experience. By their life they have shown us how to make smooth transition from a state of desire to the state of desirelessness. So we should adopt such methods by which desires themselves should leave us. That is the method of renunciation. But the transition must be smooth, must be complete. So Mahatma's life are the example for us, how they lived the life of contemplation and meditation, and how they could disidentify themselves with the samskaras of the mind. As long as you are identifying yourself with my mind, all the things in the mind are visible to me. Suppose you are in deep sleep. What happened to all the things which were disturbing you? They are not gone. They are still in the mind. But they are not disturbing you for the present, because you have gone beyond the mind and you are resting yourself completely. So, knowledge is the way to discover freedom. The freedom is in every one of us. Only we have to remove the obstacles on the way, then the freedom is got. The obstacles are the desires of the obstacles. So these are to be removed. If the desires are to be removed, means what is the meaning of removing the desires? It means mind must be cleansed. Mind must be purified. So purification of the mind. Yogaha chitta vritti nirodha. Yoga is possible. Yoga means union. The vision of God. The union of the individual self with the Paramatman, universal self, is possible only when we transcend the mind. When we are not afraid of anything of this. We are not bothered anymore. Because we are not this. So because we cling to certain things, so all the trouble comes. So we should not cling to the things. You may be there, but you may not cling to that. Kamalapatra mevambhasa. Like that we must live the life. Kamalapatra, the lotus, it lives in water. It is in water. But water doesn't stay in kamal, in lotus. So we can live in the world, but the worldliness should not drown us. You must float in the world, not sink in the world. So that is the way how we should adapt. And as I said earlier, we have to categorize the desires into different sections. Accordingly, we must deal with them. In the beginning, you must have spiritual desires to fight out the opposite ones. And in the final one, even the spiritual desires must be integrated into one single desire. The single purpose in life, that is to have that realization of the absolute reality. To know what is exactly the truth. Experience of the truth. Once you get that, you are absolutely free. And it is possible to get that state while we are in this mortal frame. It is possible to do that. It all depends upon our effort and the degree of purification in our mind, all such things. So let us pray to the Divine Spirit to make our life meaningful and blessed. Thank you. We have got a special program from August 14th to 21st. That is children's camp. We are having this camp every year. So this year also we are having this camp. And on August 28, we have got Shri Krishna Janmashtami, the worship of Lord Krishna. Om Sahana Bhavatu, Sahanau Bhunaktu, Sahaviryam Karavavahai, Tejasvinavadhitamastu Mavit Vishavahai. Om Shanti 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 Harihi Om. May the Supreme Lord protect us. May He nourish us. May our activities be performed with full of spirit through His grace. May our studies kindle our knowledge. May we be well established in peace and harmony. Peace, peace, peace be unto all.